Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is the final evidence session of an inquiry into a just transition for the North East and Moray. I welcome Richard Lockhead, Minister for Small Business, Innovation, Tourism and Trade, who is joined by Katrina Lang, Deputy Director for Climate Change with the Scottish Government. If members and witnesses can keep their questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful this morning. And I now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. I also want to begin by thanking you all for the opportunity to speak to the committee today. And I should say that your inquiry into the Just Transition Fund for North East Scotland and Moray comes at a really good time from my own perspective, because I'm very keen this year to reflect on the fund's first 2 or 3 years and also on our approach to wider just transition, which of course is continuing to evolve. It's a living, breathing concept. There's no blueprint for this. No country's done it before. So very keen to have your feedback today, and I also look forward to the outcomes of your inquiry. Clearly at the heart of the government's desire for a just transition in Scotland is that we don't want to repeat any of the past mistakes from Scotland's past. We all are aware that we're continuing to feel the impact of the rapid decline that was inflicted in many of our heavy industries, particularly in the 1980s, for instance, the closure of the coal mines, which is obviously the example that's often cited as part of this debate. So for me, a just transition is about ensuring the positive impacts of reaching net zero are felt right across our economy and the whole of society, bringing tangible benefits to all of our citizens, especially with regard to jobs and skills, affordability and living standards. Supporting positive outcome for communities and places and workers and businesses is absolutely fundamental to the just transition approach. Change, of course, is always challenging, but the North East and Moray has a crucial role to play in our transition to a greener future. So we have to harness the area's skills, talents and expertise to support the build out of our low carbon technologies and tackle existing issues of fuel poverty and energy security, as well as safeguarding a future for the many oil and gas workers and offshore workers we have, particularly in that region of Scotland. We have, of course, already undertaken a lot of work to create new jobs in the offshore wind sector in particular, and there's no doubt that the opportunities provided by Scotland's resources are vast, and that this region of Scotland that we're talking about today in particular is very well placed to take advantage of that. There are exciting projects already underway in the region, and our Just Transition Fund for the North East and Moray has committed £500 million of investment over 10 years. That, of course, is to recognise the unique circumstances of the transition of our oil and gas sector and its particular concentration in the North East. We do have an urgent responsibility to a just transition that protects opportunities for workers and communities, as well as supporting and underpinning the region's economy. Despite the relatively early stages of the fund, we've already allocated £75 million in funding. That's supported around 24 projects so far, as well as a range of other activities to support also commercial investment through the Scottish National Investment Bank going forward as well. Our funding support is helping finance organisations, businesses, communities and individuals in transition, creating jobs in low carbon industries and supporting the provision of skills in the region as well. The first Just Transition Commission has stressed the importance of a planned and managed transition to net zero. That's why we have committed to delivering just transition plans for sectors, regions and individual sites in some cases. Good planning is critical to provide certainty for these communities, businesses and workers about the changes that are going to happen and that are already underway. Accordingly, we have put engagement and co-design at the core of our planning and policy to make sure that the people who will be impacted by the transition have their say. And of course, that's our key principle of the Just Transition. Without societal buy-in, it will be impossible for us to reach net zero in a fair way. So we are making lots of progress. There's lots of lessons to learn. There's lots more to do in the future, obviously. As I said before at the beginning, there's no blueprint for this. Scotland is attracting international attention for the way in which we're approaching a just transition in Scotland. But we do have to reflect on the first couple of years of the fund in particular, as well as the overall approach. And therefore, very keen to have your thoughts. Obviously, do my best to answer your questions today and get back to you with anything I'm unable to furnish you with at this meeting. But I look forward to the exchange in today's session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Can I maybe start with a question around the meaning of a just transition? So the witnesses to this inquiry have given a number of different definitions of what a just transition is. And we went up to Aberdeen to take evidence. Aberdeen State Council said that there was some confusion in government as to what the concept of a just transition means, which leads to funding programmes where the intent isn't clear. And a lot of the discussion was around the difference between a just transition and an energy transition. Do you feel that there needs to be a greater definition? I mean, you said at the start it's a living, breathing concept, so it's the balance between flexibility and maybe the need to change and adapt, but also clarity so that everybody knows what they're working towards. Do you think there needs to be more work in that area when it comes to defining what it means for North East Murray?
It's a good question. Of course, it's a question I hear often. Scotland's in the position where the Just Transition principles are, of course, reflected in the Climate Change Act. And I explain to people when I meet them, and it's as straightforward a way as I can in terms of how I define the Just Transition, as a way in which ensuring the transition to net zero is managed and planned, and the measures we take and policies we implement to go towards net zero in a fair way, it doesn't leave people behind, is done in a way in which it's co-designed with the people most affected. And that's clearly got at the heart of it, creating good green jobs for people in Scotland, particularly those in sectors that are most impacted by the transition away from fossil fuels and to low-carbon technologies. So most people I speak to in organisations, including Aberdeen City Council, have accepted that when I've met them in the past. And I think there's a broad agreement about the aims and general principles of the Just Transition. Clearly, there is always a debate, because it can mean all things to all people. So, you know, it's not just about jobs, jobs at the heart of it, but it's also about using the economic transformation we're going through in the coming decades, between now and 2045, as a massive window of opportunity to fix things in our society and our economy that we don't think are right and we think are unfair. So fuel poverty, for instance, and, you know, many other economic issues. So it's a window of opportunity, and as we go through that economic transformation, we've got an opportunity to fix some of those things in our society.
I suppose linked to that question is the associated issue of how do you measure the just transition? So you talk about the need for it to be planned and managed, but I think it was Professor Paul Deleu, when he spoke to us, said the journey, the destination is clear, but the journey is not, and that we know what the outcomes are meant to be, but we're lacking detail of how we get there. And we also took evidence from the Just Transition Lab, and they've done quite a bit of work on how you could measure it, what kind of indicators you would use. I understand they're having some discussions with the Scottish Government. Do you think there is a need to... I know we're looking at a longer-term plan, but should we have... you know, staging, should we have measurement, should we at least attempt, I know it's a difficult thing to measure, but should we at least attempt to measure it? Because at the moment it feels it's happening in a bit of a vacuum. And so how do we know in 5 years' time if we're on the right track, or 10 years' time we're meant to have achieved this? So what work is the government doing in this area?
I agree with a lot of the sentiment that's been expressed to the committee on this issue. I mean, if you look, I've been in Parliament since 1999, and you know, many people around the table have been in Parliament for some time, so you're aware as much as I am of how quickly, how fast the agenda has changed, and how the issues of the Just Transition and net zero have rocketed to the top of the agenda in the last few years. So society, the world's changing so fast, and the debate over net zero, as we can see in the daily news, is now at the forefront. So we do have to measure better what we're achieving with the Just Transition policy in Scotland. I accept that. In terms of the fund, for instance, the first couple of years have been just getting off the ground and going. If you go to North East Scotland, for instance, there is a remarkable transformation underway. Amazing things happening. I'm lucky, as Minister, I get to visit a lot of the places and meet the people involved. And it's hugely inspirational what's happening just now in North East Scotland and other parts of the country, but in terms of the fund, the many different projects, and it's not just the Just Transition Fund, there's various other funds and initiatives underway, as you'll all be aware of in North East Scotland from your inquiry. So things are happening, and we do have to measure that. So we at the moment have biannual reports to take stock of where we are with all the fund and the projects, and I'm very keen in 2024 to develop the next phase of that. so we can have a proper reporting in place to look at the jobs implications and what's been created, as well as the wider investment. One of the issues that I have been raising with officials, so we can try and address this, is the just transition's not just one aspect of policy or one fund. There's lots of different sources of support at the moment and activity underway across Scotland, particularly in North East Scotland, that support the just transition. So we have to bring that together and tell the story, and then look as a country where we are with the just transition.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there'll be other questions around the fund in particular, but the Just Transition Lab are looking at, you know, a kind of thematic approach. So they've suggested employment, earnings and skills, and then looking at housing, poverty and wellbeing, democratic participation, and then community empowerment, revitalisation and net zero. So it recognises it's not just about the energy transition, it's not just about the skills, it is about broader areas. And I know it's difficult things to measure, but are the government having discussions with, for example, the Just Transition Lab to think, is it the aim of the government to try and set out some framework that can be managed? Is it having an impact on poverty? Is it having an impact? What kind of impact is this having on communities?
The short answer is yes, and that we warmly welcome the report from the Just Transition Lab, Aberdeen University, which is, again, a new innovation in the university of the last year or two, which shows the pace of change. They've created that lab, and I know the academics quite well that are working within that. I know the Cabinet Secretary, Mary McAllen, who of course leads this subject cabinet, was up at the university meeting at the lab recently discussing this very report. So we are very keen to take on board their recommendations as part of our thinking going forward this year.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Maggie Chapman, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for joining us this morning. I've got a few questions around community participation, community engagement, and the issues that they've brought to us. We were in Aberdeen for a day at the start of the inquiry, speaking to community groups, but also we had one of our committee meetings in Aberdeen and heard from people who either work directly with community groups or facilitate their work, local authorities included. And one of the things they said quite clearly was that actually trust in their aims and ambitions is pretty low. You know, there are a lot of fine words around what they mean. And, you know, I think we do all share the endeavour, and comes to that point, we know the end point, but we don't know how to get there. And I think there is a lack of trust within communities and community groups about exactly what that direction of travel is. And I just wondered how you answered that challenge of lack of trust that community groups have in not necessarily the Scottish Government itself, but the whole process of just transition.
Well, clearly, times are quite tough just now, as we are all aware, and I can very much understand the frustration in communities. You know, energy prices are rocketing. They're surrounded by energy resources and can't quite square why they're paying through the nose for energy bills, and we are surrounded by energy resources, and, you know, the contradiction there. And, you know, so I understand and hear some of the frustrations from community representatives and indeed just members of the communities that I meet. But I think we have begun to address that. And of course, the test will be when people see and feel change in their societies and their communities. And, you know, there are many projects underway now which I think will deliver visible change in communities in terms of energy efficiency, renewables, various other projects that have come forward. There's a bottom-up aspect to just transition here. It's not just top-down. At the heart of just transition is bottom-up. The participatory budgeting has been a success. I think 10,000 people voted in the first year. 19,000 people voted for local projects in the second year, so it's nearly 100% increase. So slowly but surely, more and more people are engaging in the just transition debates and you know, activities and projects, and expressing an interest. So we just have to build on that, and participatory budgeting is committed to going forward throughout this Parliament as part of the Just Transition Fund. But we need transformational projects, and we need transformation that people can see and feel.
No, thanks. And I get that, you know, we're just a couple of years into this process. And I hear what you say about the participatory budgeting fund. I know other people want to come on to speak about that specifically. There have been questions around the balance of that compared to the rest of it, but I'll let others cover that. I think one of the challenges, and you spoke about this in your opening remarks about, you know, wanting to and having the ambition to have a co-created just transition process that is more than just about energy. It's really an economic transition that we're looking at. It's going to affect every aspect of people's lives. And I suppose there's a question that community groups and communities have. You know, when they say something isn't working, they don't see policies changing. In, you know, whether that's local government, whether that's national government, they don't necessarily see. They say that they've said, you know, we want this to happen in our community, and the policies around them don't join up. They don't enable. They don't facilitate. And I think there's a frustration, not only around that the lack of trust, which we've spoken about, but of things not being joined up. And I wondered what, and it's not necessarily about resource. It's about approach. I just wondered how your conversations with local authorities and other public agencies in the region and the government itself, how those conversations are going around making sure things are actually joined up, and we're getting away from the siloing of, you know, whether it's planning or whatever it is. If it's not just energy we focused on, and I think we all agree it can't be, how are we making sure that we think across departments and we don't end up with siloed disconnect?
So I can speak to what's happening within governments and to a certain extent the public sector, but clearly the just transition is a concept and an approach that has to be adopted by all parts of society. It's not just for government alone. You know, the business community, local community groups, local governments, as well as, you know, the wider public sector and Scottish governments. So in Scottish Government, clearly all ministers and cabinet secretaries are engaged in delivering a just transition through their own portfolios. And as we take forward the various plans that we may come on to in next further questions, you know, each minister and cabinet secretary is responsible for those. It's not myself or Mary McCallum, the cabinet secretary, it's solely responsible for taking them forward. So that knocking down the silos and cross government working will hopefully move forward in a positive way. There's a lot of the challenges you mentioned are applicable to society generally, not just transition, trying mm-hmm. to knock down the silos, trying to get everyone to working together, mm-hmm. going in one direction. And I absolutely understand how communities can get frustrated when they don't see that.
I suppose there's a
question, yeah. Then I'll move to Kim's.
Yeah, there's a very, very particular point about, you know, engagement happens, communities tell government what they want or what they think should happen, and nothing changes. I think that's a problem that we need to address. And I think that's linked to a sense that communities can jump up and down all they like, but it's the usual suspects that get their way. And I'm just wondering, I hear what you said earlier about we needing to, you know, see progress. We need to see the change, and then people will realise the benefits. But I'm not sure that communities are clear how that change is going to happen with their involvement, and it isn't just going to be the usual suspects, that the players that are already active, already quite powerful in the region, are having the say, the final word, if you like.
Yeah. I do understand the concern, and I absolutely identify with it. You know, capacity building is a big theme as well, to ensure that it's not just the loudest voices and the same voices are commanding all the attention of the public sector or the Scottish Government or whoever else. That's, again, not just an argument that applies to this debate, that applies right across the board. So capacity building is really important, and we do have to find ways of ensuring that local government, central governments, who have a lot of influence over this, can work closer together to try and make sure all voices are heard, and that we do find ways, if we can, because resources are so tight just now, yeah, of building capacity to ensure that it's not just the loudest voices that listen to. As Minister, I make a special effort to make sure I'm not listening just to the usual voices and the loudest voices, and I'm confident my colleagues do that as well. So as the participatory budgeting process shows, we are beginning to, you know, involve more and more people in this.
Okay, thanks.
I think Gina maybe just wants to add a small...
So, firstly, absolutely recognise the challenge that has been presented by these two first sets of questions. And I would contrast the process of the Just Transition work with the work on climate change and decarbonisation. Decarbonisation is much easier to measure, and it's much easier to communicate exactly what that means to people. It's quite immediate, and it's quite stark. However challenging that is, and it's very challenging to decarbonise, at least you can measure your progress and communicate what you're doing quite quickly. I think the Just Transition, because it has economic, jobs, environmental, community-based fairness aspects, it can't be that kind of one measure. And so I think the challenge that we have with working with the Just Transition Commission and the Just Transition Lab and others who advise us is, how do we firstly measure our success, and secondly, how do we communicate that to people? And that is definitely a work in progress. It's not straightforward, but it certainly, as the Minister has said, one of our priorities for the year ahead. I think in terms of communities, I think that is going to be an ongoing challenge. I don't think that in 3 years' time we will have cracked it. You know, I don't think we're ever going to solve it. But I think it is something we prioritise, and it is something that we are continuing to work on. So one aspect of that is that when we were working on the Just Transition draft plans, which goes beyond energy, so it's transport, it's land use and agriculture, it's construction, over the summer we conducted a series of events where we went across Scotland to talk to different communities, and not just the voices that are usually heard, but groups with protected characteristics, community groups, women, people with disabilities. We were listening across the spectrum and then trying to draw some of the priorities that communities have out of that as part of what we want to form in the Just Transition plans. And with respect to North East and Moray, when we were working on the Just Transition Fund, it wasn't easy to put together a quick framework that said, this is what we're trying to achieve. Because as the Minister says, it is partially about jobs, but it's also about skills. It's also about the environment. It's also about community participation. And so the way that we did that within a constrained time frame was to talk to councils and local authorities, to talk to green MSPs, to talk to communities themselves about what they wanted to see from that fund. And then we made sure that we were choosing projects in conjunction with people like Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise and councils, rather than doing it ourselves. And as the Minister said, participatory budgeting is an important aspect of that fund, albeit I would accept a challenge that, you know, it wouldn't necessarily be everybody wouldn't always have said how much proportionally we've put into that and agree with it. But it is it is constantly a part of what we do and try to prioritise.
OK, thank you. Kevin Stewart, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you very much, and good morning, Minister. We spent a fair amount of time with community organisations in Aberdeen, and Maggie Chapman has touched upon the trust aspect. One of the things which was also apparent was some folk felt that there was a lack of transparency around about where monies were going. Obviously, you've highlighted the participatory budgeting scenario. A lot of the folks that we talked to had been involved in that, were very positive about that and very positive about their own project, of course. But they did not have a clear understanding of some of the other resources that have been has been allocated, particularly to business. And without giving one of the examples that came up in depth, they mentioned to me one particular business that had received substantial funding, and they were unhappy with that. But when it was explained to them by myself what that money was for, attitude changed completely and utterly, because they then understood why it is. So do you think that we are doing enough to be absolutely open and transparent and communicating the reasons why it is that we're allocating certain sums of money as we are doing?
Well, on one hand, it's a powerful point that Kevin Stewart makes there. I do think we're open and transparent. Everything is able to be in the public domain in terms of who's receiving the monies and the grants and the various projects that are being supported. However, clearly there is a communication challenge. If that's your experience, and I'm sure it's not the only experience, I often speak to people as well who are suspicious of X amount of money going to businesses and not to community groups. And I, you know, there's obviously some tensions within that whole debate, because clearly I have to explain that if we're going to transform the economy, we have to work with the business community, we have to support big transformational projects that will create potentially hundreds if not thousands of jobs in the coming years. We can't achieve that transformation without supporting projects like that. But likewise, we do want to support smaller projects and communities, and understand that people want full transparency and to understand the rationale behind those decisions.
I wonder, Minister, because you talked about the twice yearly reporting on this, I wonder if it would be beneficial, if, taking commercial sensitivity aside, if we could actually let folk know, communities know, the people of North East and Murray know, what the allocations are actually being used for. Because I do think that if we actually let people know and be as open and transparent as possible, then they come along with us. You know, there was a huge amount of positivity for the community aspect, less of a positivity for the business grants that have been made. But, you know, when that was explained, the reasoning why certain things had happened, that positivity grew. So can we get that comms right as we move forward? Please, would be my plea.
Well, I agree with you, we have to, and I'll certainly reflect on your points. As I said at the beginning as well, I think there's, as we go through this just transition process, there's a couple of communication challenges. One is ensuring that everyone's aware of how the fund is working and making a difference in North East Scotland and Murray, but secondly, how there's a lot of other activities happening in Scotland just now that support the just transition, and we have to bring that together and tell the big picture and the full story. So I think on those two levels, I'm very keen to pursue that this year.
Thank you. You said earlier on that this has to be a bottom-up process, and we have to listen to people. And, you know, certainly that's how I think that should happen. I think that we are getting there, and people in the main feel involved. But in terms of some of the discussion around about that bottom-up aspect, there were some frustrations, it would be fair to say, around about resource that's available. Now, I recognise that the Scottish Government have come up with the Just Transition Fund, for which we're very grateful. A lot of that funding, though, is capital funding. And particularly from community organisations, they feel that there needs to be much more access to revenue resource funding. I wonder, Minister, if there is a way that there could be cooperation between all of the public services to match up some of the resource funding that is required to allow certain projects to get off the ground. And also, I'd be interested to hear any comment that you have around about communication with the UK government to try and get them to match the Just Transition funding that the Scottish Government has put in to the North East and Murray.
Thanks. Firstly, in terms of the revenue support for the Just Transition and all of these projects, that would have massive, you know, financial implications and ongoing implications. I don't need to tell the committee how tough things are financially just now in the public sector and for governments. Therefore, I don't have an easy answer to that at the moment. All I can do is continue to reflect upon it. Obviously, if the committee refers to that in your inquiry report, you know, we'll again use that opportunity to give further reflection to it. But I just, it's just a financial issue in terms of revenue support, and also capital as a way to achieve transformation. And the capital investments often bring in and unlock private sector investments. So, you know, we're getting even more transformational projects through that means. So that's why there's a big focus on capital. However, you know, the point's well made. In terms of interaction with the UK government, you know, up to £400 billion has been taken out of the North Sea and oil and gas revenues over the past decades. And we, therefore, have made the point many times, UK government, that we believe they could match the Just Transition Fund for North East Scotland, and we'll continue to make that point.
I hope you will.
This could be your final question. I'll move on to Colin.
I hope you will continue to make that point as a North East representative. I certainly will be as we move forward. You talked about that capital monies bringing in further financing resource from the private sector. But I wonder, Minister, and again, I know this is early days, are we seeing changes in terms of the spend of the other public sector bodies in order to get the very best out of the Just Transition Fund? Or do you think there's more work to do in that regard with the councils, with the health boards, etc., etc.?
There are a number of projects where just transition funding is just one part of the funding for the project, and which is you know, clearly unlocked, and there's been collaboration with outside investment as well. So it's playing a valuable role in that context. And the enterprise companies and local authorities are working closely with the Scottish Government, and we consult them closely in all the projects that are funded through the Just Transition Fund. So no doubt there's more work to be done and more we could do there to make sure that momentum continues with that collaboration and jointly funding projects. So again, we'll continue to reflect upon that, but there are some good examples out there at the moment.
Thank you.
Colin Beattie to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Vina. Morning, Minister. This committee, over the course of this evidence taking, has looked at aspects of the development of the Just Transition plans and how joined up these are. And in that regard, can I ask you what coordination has there been between the Scottish Government and, for example, the UK Government and local authorities? And secondly, do the plans align with those other different layers of government?
Interaction with UK Government over Just Transition largely would revolve around the North Sea Transition Deal and these initiatives, where there's common aims, and that is supporting a range of projects in North East Scotland, as are other UK funds where we are able to secure them. I think a lot of the projects that are supported, hopefully, by the UK Government as well as the Scottish Government, are bottom-up projects. So they're proposals from the North East of Scotland. I think of the Net Zero Technology Centre, which is a fantastic initiative and project in Aberdeen. I think I'm right in saying that's attracted UK monies as well as Scottish. So there are projects there which originate in the North East of Scotland and attract UK funds, and they've got a Just Transition theme to them. I'm sure there's more capacity for ensuring the UK government are working closer with us on Just Transition principles. There's a lot of engagement on Just Transition, but particularly climate change and net zero funds and offshore policy.
I mean, you focus there on the UK government and on individual projects where hopefully the two governments are working together. Is there a sort of an overall picture of cooperation and coordination with the UK government, and not forgetting local authorities?
It's one of the issues that I want to reflect upon this year, reflecting in the first couple of years of the Just Transition Fund and the wider policy, because we do need support of the UK government, and we need support of all local government Scotland as well. But I am impressed by how, particularly in Scotland, the just transition is increasingly reflected in decisions. And obviously, even in terms of the UK government, if you look at the growth deals, which is probably one of the more positive examples of cooperation between the Scottish Government and UK Government, who have actually been able to work together. The growth deals are a good example of innovative projects in the just transition, stroke, net zero space and innovation space emerging and being funded jointly by the UK Government and Scottish Government. So I do think there's a lot more to do in terms of joining up within Scotland.
Just to continuing on the coordination with the UK Government, the Just Transition Lab, and I quote, states that the UK and Scottish Governments have wildly different approaches to net zero, unquote. How does that affect your just transition plans? Does it affect it at all? Is it actually so divergent? Now, we know that there's been changes in UK government policy recently which might impact on their climate change plans. To what extent are we actually in the knowledge on that and being updated on that?
Well, clearly, in terms of the just transition, UK decisions are fundamental. We saw the recent change in the offer to offshore wind projects, which the UK government had to revisit after there was a lack of applications for offshore wind sites in the recent licensing rounds. They took a decision, obviously, to address that in light of the lack of applications, to encourage more offshore wind license applications. The spending priorities of the UK government influence hugely the ability to implement a just transition in Scotland. Just now, of course, the Scottish government is dealing with a very difficult budget settlement, which impacts what we can invest in all kinds of just transition activities and the net zero agenda. And I think that's well documented, and the Cabinet and the First Minister and others have made lots of comment on that. So, yeah, I mean, there's just a general principle there that the funding decisions of the UK government, which often are not helpful, have a direct impact on the ability to deliver just transition in Scotland.
But the statement that the approaches of the two governments are wildly different, would you agree with that assessment?
Well, clearly we saw the furore recently when the UK Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, backtracked on some of his climate change commitments. We wouldn't have done that in Scotland if we'd had a say over some of these policy areas. So there is obviously divergence in some areas, and we just have to continue to work with the UK government to persuade them to invest in the right priorities and also to give Scotland a decent budget settlement to enable us to fulfil our responsibilities to deliver a just transition in Scotland.
I mean, divergence in certain areas perhaps is not unreasonable, given the devolved settlement and so on, but wildly different is fairly extreme in terms of a statement for anyone to make. Is it a statement you would agree with?
Well, wildly different. I think, of course, there are examples where we would not support nuclear power in Scotland. We would put the billions of investment that are going to go into that from the public purse into renewables and green technologies and the net zero agenda in Scotland. So clearly there are massive differences in some areas of policy north and south of the border and between UK government and Scottish government. So wildly different, perhaps one way of describing it. It's interesting that external bodies are now taking that view.
Okay, thank you. Colin Smith.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. Can I turn to the issue of skills? During the committee's evidence, we heard criticism, for example, from the Just Transition Partnership that a skills passport has not been delivered despite being committed to in 2021. So can I ask Minister, why is progress towards delivering that skills passport stalled, and when can workers expect to see it delivered?
Thank you to Colin Smith for the question. It's a very important issue because the Scottish Government take the development of a skills passport very seriously, and of course it's something that I think there's good cross-party support in the Parliament for, to make it easier for people working, for instance, in oil and gas, to transfer their skills and employment into renewable energy and other green technologies. It's making progress. I had a catch-up meeting a few weeks ago with some of the stakeholders on the working group dealing with this, and of course the Scottish Government gave a deadline to the working group of the end of March to try and get this concluded. There's a lot of work being taken place, I think actually stakeholders are meeting next week or next week or two for the next meeting, and it's been a big task trying to align standards amongst the various sectors involved, between renewables and oil and gas in particular, obviously, in this case. There's got to be alignment of standards, there's got to be alignment of training requirements, and I think there's been some areas clearly that have taken a lot longer to iron out than we'd have hoped. So I'm hopeful that we'll have a conclusion by the end of March, which is the deadline we've laid down.
Just on that, so the end of March, a target to introduce a passport, or simply to report back on the work?
To give us the solution that they're working on just now. Okay. To enable us then to introduce it, but that's when we're asking the group to come back to us with the final version of the digital passport.
Okay. During our evidence, Scottish Renewables pointed out that many workers in the sector are currently having to fund reskilling or upskilling out of their own pockets. Unite the Union estimated this costs workers around £2,000. And Skills Development Scotland stated there's capacity in the skills development pipeline, to quote them, if we get the financial resources to apply it, for example, to support apprenticeships. So can I ask Minister, are the government doing enough to support workers to reskill, given the fact that they are having to fund it themselves in many cases? And what further action do the government plan to take to support them?
Well, clearly, the skills issue is the heart of the just transition and ensuring it's as smooth as possible for people to transfer their skills into different sectors. There's a lot of work underway just now. Skills Development Scotland have been doing a lot of work with the apprenticeships in green industries. That's making good progress. Clearly, there's a number of initiatives being funded through the Just Transition Fund in North East Scotland that addresses this issue as well. And clearly, we expect companies themselves to play a role in funding training for their own workforces, which is always the case. That should certainly be the case with the Just Transition at the same time. We are actively looking at a lot of this just now, and can assure Colin Smith, and we, of course, have got the commitment to refresh the Climate Change Skills Action Plan and the work that flows out of that, which we're looking at how that joins up with the rest of the skills issues within the space. And we've had the James Withers report, which, of course, also mentioned the energy transition and net zero at the core of his recommendations for how we change the landscape in Scotland over skills and training. So that's kind of all been looked at just now and is very active.
But obviously, crucial to this is funding. If Unite are pointing out that workers are going to pay £2,000 to reskill themselves, at Skills Development Scotland, you mentioned around apprenticeships, but we've seen that being reduced. And I think to quote SDS in their evidence to committee, what they said is for skills, we need more revenue resource for training activities. But obviously, the recent budget proposes a £4.1 million cut in SDS budget. We've got the skills budget being cut from £50.6 million to £36.9 million. We're seeing cuts also coming to colleges. So I'm just, if we've already got a problem where workers are effectively funding the reskilling themselves, yet we're seeing probably reductions in funding, where do you see the funding coming from to support workers? You know, Kevin Stewart raised the point about the transition fund, but again, Skills Development Scotland told the committee, the point that Kevin made, that it's mainly capital, but what they need is revenue. So I'm just curious as to where the funding to tackle this issue is going to come from. What sort of proposals do the government have?
Well, I mean, the first point I'd make is that if any MSP or party in Parliament believes that the budget needs amended, it's a draft budget before Parliament just now, and they can use the opportunity to put forward proposals if they can explain where the alternative resources are going to come from to increase any particular budget. The financial environment is very tight just now. I can't sit here and give guarantees of substantial increases in such funds at the moment. But what I can say in terms of whether it's apprenticeships, there has been an increase in the number of apprenticeships for green industries and so on. So I know the members made a reference about the overall picture, but I'm talking here about this particular agenda. So I think things are going in the right direction. I think that we have invested in a lot of really good training and skills initiatives through the Just Transition Fund and indeed the special fund that was set up for this purpose over the last few years as well, because we've got the Energy Transition Fund and we had the Training Fund as well. So there's a lot of good initiatives underway in Scotland right now that are being supported from the public purse. I'm happy to look at the specific issue of employees paying for their own training and come back to the committee on that point, if that's helpful.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Smith. I'll bring in Brian Whittle and then I'll bring in Gordon MacDonald.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, Minister. Just to follow on from Colin Smith's questioning, I was speaking to an international recruitment company who were claiming that they're stripping out a lot of talent out of the North Sea and it's shipping it abroad. Now, difficult to measure that, but it does seem reasonable that is potentially could be happening. One of the things we need to do is ensure that the jobs are available and that the journey from fossil fuel to renewables, renewable jobs, is as smooth and as simple as possible, because we need to keep these people in Scotland. So is the Scottish Government doing any work to measure around the number of green jobs of that sort of standard are being created and how that transition is being delivered from oil and gas?
So Skills Development Scotland do their own skills assessments, and I'm not, obviously I think they gave evidence to your committee, I'm not sure whether that was raised with them directly, but there's a lot of work again underway in Skills Development Scotland, have carried that out already and continue to do that on a regular basis in terms of skills assessments for the green energy sectors and of course the rest of the sectors in Scotland as well. The Energy Transition Zone in Aberdeen, for instance, is creating 5 skills hubs. And the Cabinet Secretary, Mary McCallum, was at the launch of the key hub at North East Scotland College recently, which the Scottish Government are giving, I think it's around £4 to £5 million towards. So there's a lot of exciting initiatives happening. In terms of monitoring and the skills, obviously RGU carried out a lot of work, which the Scottish Government often refers to, laying out the challenges of the skills requirements between now and 2040, 2050. And of course, RGU showed that actually we could have more energy jobs than what we have just now in North East Scotland and indeed the country if we play our cards right. Many companies that speak to me talk about skills shortages and labour shortages. So it's not just an issue of people transferring from one sector to another. If people are looking for jobs, quite often there is a job available for them. So it's making sure we've got the upskilling in place, and RGU and the University of Aberdeen and others in North East Scotland in this area are doing a lot of work on that in terms of upskilling, short courses and so on. So we have to support that going forward.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, to be followed by Myrtle Fraser.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I just want to continue this conversation we've got about the job situation. You quite rightly touched upon the RGU report making the switch, and they highlighted that 90% of North Sea workers already have medium to high skills that are transferable to adjacent energy. And they suggested that if we get this right, we could have 54,000 jobs in 2030. And the government's own figures say 77,000 jobs by 2050. Now, other than skills, what are the challenges facing the North East in becoming the global energy hub in order that they can look after the installed offshore wind, hydrogen generation and carbon capture and storage? What are the challenges that are facing them in order that we can get this 77,000 jobs?
Challenges? Well, the challenges are clearly we need the transformational projects up and running as quickly as possible, and we need them to get underway, whether it's offshore or whether it's many of the onshore projects that are being looked at the moment in terms of carbon capture and storage plans and so on and so forth. Clearly, the UK government's got a big role to play here as well, because this is not all in our hands as a Scottish government. So we need the UK government to put its shoulder to the wheel in terms of doing everything it can to ensure the carbon capture and storage plans are moving forward at pace. We finally go over the hurdle of the Acorn project getting the go-ahead. It took a long time to get there and far too long, because there's tens of thousands of jobs that will be created through that alone. There's also the wider economic environment, which is a challenge. At a time of high interest rates, of course, that's an impact on decisions that are taken to invest in new capital projects, in pipeline projects and the pace at which they can be brought forward is all influenced by the wider macroeconomic environment. Again, that's not just the Scottish Government, it's obviously a UK Government issue as well. So these are the kinds of challenges. On the jobs issue, of course, it's really important to make a couple of points that I would like to convey to the committee. Firstly, that Scotland is leading virtually all the league tables across the UK for the creation of green jobs. We're ahead, whether it's PwC, whether it's EY's analysis, various other analysis that have been carried out. We are creating and advertising for more green jobs in Scotland than any other part of the UK, and that's consistent. So there is a green job revolution underway in Scotland at the moment, and we should hopefully appreciate that. I know some people want to go faster, and I understand that obviously as well, and we need to do more, but there is a green jobs revolution underway in Scotland as we speak. Independent research carried out by, I think it was University of Warwick, at the behest of Skills Development Scotland, said it was up to 100,000 new green jobs being created in Scotland. And we saw the recent Fraser Allister Institute report commissioned by Scottish Renewables saying that there were, I'm just trying to remember the figure, 42,000 full-time equivalent jobs in renewables now in Scotland. And often other figures are quoted, but that's the latest figure, is 42,000. So it's all going in the right direction. There's tens of thousands of new jobs being created in Scotland in green sectors. Another aspect which I think we have to get to the bottom of is often I visit businesses in North East Scotland, in particular in Aberdeen, who are counted as oil and gas companies, but they're doing 50, 70% of their work in renewables. So we have to work with, again, it's often the ONS and other authorities who collect the statistics and define the statistics. We have to work on that to make sure they're more accurate. Because I do find it ironic I'm going to a company classed as engineering or oil and gas, which is working renewables. So we have to capture that because, again, that's part of the renewables revolution and the green jobs revolution that's happening in Scotland just now as well.
So I just want to look at some of the other barriers, and one you didn't touch upon was finance. The same RGU report said that we require over $17 billion in new regional investment between 2022 and 2030 to manufacture and operational capabilities for the renewable sector. And the Crown Estate Scotland noted that a recent foreign direct investment intelligence report reported that $54 billion was pledged to wind power in Scotland, but required the creation of a low-risk and attractive business environment. Can you say anything about the challenges facing the financial situation?
Clearly, this is a massive issue in Scotland, but it's a global issue at the same time of how to attract green investments for the world's move towards net zero, and in terms of Scotland, to make sure we realise the energy potential, for instance, in offshore wind and other technologies to create the jobs we want to see for the future. So there's activity underway just now to attract more capital investment to Scotland. We've got a capital investment plan. We've had the First Minister's recent panel reporting on how to attract international investment to Scotland to fund net zero. And there's recommendations from that that are being looked at now and considered by government of what we can do to deliver them. We have had a lot of activity in this space over the last few months and years from the private capital markets and players, as well as public sector and Scottish Government initiatives. In terms of challenges, again, it kind of goes back to my previous answer. Obviously, at a time of high interest rates, and we've seen some economic instability at UK level over the last year or two, that doesn't help that stable environment. What I do get back, because I'm also sitting before you today as the Minister for Trade, is when I'm speaking to inward investors around the world, they are full of praise for Scotland. And I don't just sit here as a Minister of the Government saying that because I want to say good things. It is eye-opening to hear what people outside of Scotland say about Scotland. And we don't hear it enough because we hear a lot of negativity in our own country. But when I'm speaking to companies overseas, they're very positive about Scotland. What they say to me is that why they're attracted to investing in Scotland and our energy transition in particular, but not just that technology, lots of other sectors, is because they've seen a long-term commitment to net zero in Scotland. They've seen a stable and committed policy in Scotland towards net zero. Now, the government's been in power here since 2007, so I think that's helped greatly, because we're able to have that long-term commitment there. So that's what I hear from international investors. So I think that is going to deliver a lot of dividends for Scotland.
And my last point in terms of barriers to this just transition we're trying to achieve, Aberdeen Chamber of Commerce, Scottish National Investment Bank, Scottish Renewables and SSE Group all highlighted grid connection issues as a barrier to developing offshore wind. Can you say anything about what needs to change in that direction?
Well, yes, and I should have addressed that point. It's a very important point to raise in my earlier answer to your question about challenges. Yeah. So a massive challenge, clearly, is ensuring the grid can deliver. Yeah. And that's in terms of delivering the just transition. We need projects up and running that will deliver the jobs, that will deliver the activity, the revenues. To get those the big projects up and running, they need access to the grid. And that, of course, is one of the biggest challenges. I know my Energy Minister colleague, Gillian Martin, as well as Neil Gray, the Cabinet Secretary, and others have been doing a lot of work on this as part of the development of the energy policy. The final strategy, of course, will be delivered and published in by the summer. So the grid has been adapting its policies, and there's now a lot of initiatives underway from the National Grid to try and prioritise renewable energy developments. So that's a very important aspect to raise. I'm happy to write back to the committee on that. Obviously, I'm not the minister directly dealing with the National Grid on this, but there has been a lot of activity over the last 12 months.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Just before we bring in Murdo Fraser, I suppose linked to that is the issue of planning. So groups were also organising how long it takes to get consents. It was SSE said that currently the average offshore wind farm takes around 12 years to deliver. And major network infrastructure can take longer. And while the National Planning Framework did address some of the issues with that, there's still a recognition that it is a long process, it's very time-consuming, and it can damage our ability to be an early mover on some of this. I know you're not the Planning Minister, but can you tell us what action the government has taken? Is there a recognition of how long it has taken to consent and how it's creating a barrier for business to move forward in this area?
Yes, that is an area where the Scottish Government does have influence and responsibility in terms of one of the challenges, and we do recognise it. And if Tom Arthur was sitting before you, my ministerial colleague, he would explain to you how the latest National Planning Framework, of course, prioritises renewable energy developments, and that should speed up the process for them. And also the recently published onshore wind sector deal, which, lays down what we expect to be delivered by onshore wind developers for Scotland's benefit, but likewise gives commitments from the Scottish Government to help develop Scotland's onshore wind potential. It has a commitment within it to drastically reduce the time for the licensing and the planning.
It might be something that we pick up. We might contact the Minister, because while that is the update is welcome, it's the timescales attached to that. How long will it take until these changes are delivered? But I'll bring in Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Other colleagues have touched on the Just Transition Fund, but got a few more questions specifically on the fund and how it operates. Some of the witnesses we've taken evidence from have told us they're not clear what the fund's objectives are or how it will be monitored and evaluated. So I wonder if you could say how the Scottish Government sees the objectives of the fund and also how you expect to monitor and evaluate how that money is being spent.
Yeah. So they're very good questions, and I think we did touch upon that briefly earlier, and I am determined in 2024 to try and make sure we move forward on this. The first couple of years were very focused on getting the fund up and running, and if we'd waited to answer some of those questions, we'd have been criticised quite rightly for not getting the fund up and running and taking a couple of years to sort out the processes behind the scenes. So there are, of course, processes in place, but we absolutely understand that we have to show how everything's been measured going forward. In terms of the objectives of the fund, clearly the fund is to support the strengthening of the economy in North East Scotland and Moray and to decarbonise. and to deliver the principles which I've already discussed of the just transition. So we want the projects and how the funding is used to be co-designed, and we want a bottom-up approach within the region. That has been happening. The just transition is about creating good green jobs as well as strengthening communities. So there's a variety of projects within that. And I'm trying to remember the name of that film. Is it Everything Everywhere All at Once? And then some people I speak to see the fund like that. It should deliver everything. Because you know, you can kind of take any subject and you could perhaps get it under the remit of the Just Transition Fund. So we've had to, of course, filter out and make sure that the projects that we have coming forward, we discuss with the local enterprise companies, local authorities, and we take a decision of what are the best projects to deliver the broad objectives of the Just Transition Fund.
Okay, thanks very much for that. Some of the community groups we spoke to, and also some of the local authorities we spoke to, did express some concern about the role of SNB as the key driver, the lack of engagement with SNB. So, given SNB is, you know, intended to be an arm's length independent body, how does Scottish Government ensure that SNB will deliver on the objectives of the fund if it's also got an element of freedom of operation?
You're right in that SNB, the Scottish National Investment Bank, are at arm's length clearly from ministers. We allocated £25 million of financial transactions funding to the bank. The decisions over how that is actually invested in which projects are decisions for the bank. However, one of the objectives of the bank clearly is to support the net zero agenda, and you know, in terms of the £25 million allocation, it's towards just transition. So the actual projects will be delivered and chosen by the banks, not ministers, because they're at arm's length. But clearly, our expectation and agreement is this is funded from the Just Transition Fund, the £25 million. Now, the reason why the bank is used is clearly they have a lot of experience in using financial transactions. Financial transactions is a resource provided to the Scottish Government from the UK Government. It's complex. It's effectively long-term loans, but very long-term. But it's a way in which we can support capital investment, and that's why it's part of the Just Transition Fund, because clearly we don't have the capital to fund everything we'd like to fund, so we use the financial transactions. So that's the reason why the bank's used. In terms of transparency with the bank, clearly, I'm trying to recall, I think you took evidence maybe from the bank or you heard from them. That is an issue to raise directly with the bank. I'll certainly reflect on that for our next conversations with them. But, you know, once the announcements are made, that will be in the public domain.
Okay. The other issue that came up quite a lot, particularly from the community groups, was there was funding for capital, but not for revenue. And this means that if they've got projects that are intended to run over a period of years, it's difficult to find secure funding to sustain these. Is that something you're conscious of? And is there anything can be done in that space?
Well, I'm certainly conscious of it, and it's certainly a bigger issue for applicants that clearly don't have the capacity or other sources of revenue for the ongoing commitment for particular types of projects. So the smaller the organisation, for instance, clearly is going to face the bigger challenge. This gets back to my original point in that the Just Transition Fund has got to be transformational. You know, in 10 years' time, I believe we have to look back and think that's £500 million from public purse invested into the Just Transition in North East Scotland and Moray, and we can see how it's been transformational. And we have to look back at that point in time and see it's been transformational. We can only do that by supporting transformational projects. Now, as part of Just Transition principles, it's not just big shiny projects that have to be funded. We want to fund, you know, community projects, and that can be a variety of different types of projects. But capital clearly is needed for transformational projects. The emphasis is capital. And obviously, as I said before, the financial constraints we face just now mean that, you know, ongoing revenue commitments would not necessarily be affordable. So, yes, I'm conscious of it. Yes, I'm always keen to investigate what more we can do, particularly for smaller organisations.
Okay. Lastly, Convener, for me, just on the quantum of funding. So, according to the figures we've had, in 23-24, in the current year, the funding was allocated at 50 million. For the next financial year, it's 12 million. So why the big reduction in funding in the coming year?
Well, we have our £75 million commitments, and we have in the draft budget, as part of that, the ongoing commitment of the £12.2 million. That's because of the capital constraints we face as a government. Both financial transactions and capital funding have been reduced from the UK government. As you'll know, it's well documented, as the Finance Secretary said, 10% in real terms. So that just gives us challenges. We'd like to be in a position to put more resource into the Just Transition Fund. Clearly, it's a draft budget before Parliament just now, so I can't say too much until we're sitting here with the final figures in due course. But I just want to make clear to the committee, obviously, that's just due to financial challenges. So we'll have ground to make up, and we have the commitment in place of £500 million within 10 years. So let's all hope that the financial environment improves sooner rather than later to enable us to fund all the vital projects we need for the Just Transition.
But the trajectory is not encouraging. If it's 50 million this year, going down to 12 next year. I mean, are you confident you're going to get to the 500 million?
Well, we have £75 million we wouldn't have otherwise had if we hadn't had a Just Transition Fund just for North East Scotland and Moray, and it's a fund which is not available from the UK government, it's the Scottish government, so it's an added value fund.
Okay, all right, thank you.
I'll bring Brian Whittle in a second, but in terms of the fund, you know, we hear what you're saying about financial restrictions, but this is a 10-year project, so we do need to kind of look towards the horizon and the end point here. And the Just Transition Lab, there has been some concerns raised around when we talk about financial transactions that is more suited to the commercial sector and to bigger players, and for more community-driven projects, it's difficult for them to access that funding. I mean, you've said the restrictions there are on it in the coming financial year, but do you see a way in which there could be more funding available for more community projects, but ones that are on a scale? We're not talking about the fund that is for fixing the Scout Hall, and which is valuable, but that, you know, that's, we met things that are on a bigger scale. What kind of funding would be available? Do you see that being funding that would be available to them during this 10-year period? And how do we shift the funding to that area, or make it accessible to that area rather than shift it?
Yeah. So I understand that tension, and I've heard that argument and that point many times. Firstly, yes, there will be funding for projects of that nature as we move through the 10-year fund. Already some projects are being funded. In terms of the balance, we will clearly pay attention to the balance between the kinds of projects that are being supported. But I have to return to the fact that we have to be transformational. Now, transformation can happen at different levels. I'm not just saying that's only through larger projects, but we are supporting at the moment lots of SMEs. We're working with the Energy Transition Zone, they get funding. They've funded 10 companies, SMEs, last year, and 14 companies, I think, have just been lucky enough in their latest rounds for their energy transition fund that they have. There's a full name to the fund, which I can give you in a second or two, but it's called the Supply Chain and Energy Transition Challenge Fund. So that's already supported 24 projects, 24 SMEs, if I'm right, through that fund. So SMEs are getting supported. It's not just large projects. And as I said before, some community projects have been funded as well. So going forward, yes, we'll pay attention to that balance, but we have to absolutely pay attention to transformational projects. Transformational projects can be very expensive. You know, if you're changing the kind of energy you use in a community, that's a very expensive project. So, you know, we just have to make sure they're transformational. But also, the Just Transition Fund is not the only fund that's funding the Just Transition in North East Scotland and Moray. There's many other funds. The Green Jobs Fund's been supporting the creation of green jobs and helping SMEs as well. That's £100 million commitment over 5 years. And already we've seen, you know, the enterprise companies deliver that fund. So there's various funds supporting Just Transition.
The transformational is not always about, you know, you give the example of energy change. That is giving us benefits in terms of achieving net zero because we're decarbonising. But transformational is also about how it invests in a community and empowers a community. And that goes back to some of the other questions about deindustrialisation we've had before, where communities were left behind. So it's just about understanding what transformational is. It is about the nuts and bolts of making the change and getting us to net zero, but it is also about how you transform a community in it and involve a community in it. And you'll know that we did an inquiry into Grangemouth, and the committee have taken further evidence in Grangemouth because we are concerned about the announcements there. And that, from the outside, is looking quite concerning and isn't really looking like a just transition. It's how do we prevent that happening and make sure the investment is going in directly to communities and empowering them to take more ownership of projects.
Yes, it's a very good point, and I do recognise that, and we will absolutely monitor that and listen to concerns expressed by community groups or indeed the Just Transition Lab as well. And indeed, you may reflect some of those concerns in your report, which we'll respond to in due course.
That's a very open question, Minister. I just want to
assure the committee that there are many projects being funded. I've got a list here, and obviously I can only hold this up at the moment. These are lists of projects over many, many pages that are through the North East and Murray Just Transition Fund alone. And there's many other funds which are not covered by these projects.
So just to assure
the committee that amongst those projects, I'm happy to make sure this is all copied to the committee, there are some community projects as well as, you know, business projects and big projects. So it's just trying to balance being transformational with ensuring there's change at a community level, and we've got bottom-up projects, and I absolutely understand that.
And I'll bring in Brian Whittle, but as other members have said, there is issues around the yearly allocation of the fund, and you did say, I think, 2020 this year is when you're looking to maybe review the fund, because while it was capital, when we met with local groups, while they were all very grateful for the money they received, and it is making a difference to their organisations, the timescales they had to work to, especially for a capital project, it had to be something that was ready to go, rather than something that they were kind of working towards. So there are areas I think the committee will reflect on the report about how the fund was distributed and what improvements can be made to that, but I'll bring in Brian Whittle.
Thank you. I mean, it's actually on that point. I mean, one of the things I would note, Minister, is you did point out that there's a, I think the figure was 10% reduction, you said. I think 50 million to 12 million, if I go back to my school mathematics, is a lot more than 10%, and I think, as the convener just highlighted, a lot of witnesses have spoken about this, the need for a multi-year and revenue funding for the Just Transition Fund, because they spend so much of their time applying for the fund on an annual basis, and then have a very short period of time in which that money has to be spent. I wonder, is there a recognition within the Scottish Government there are limitations to an annual funding agreement? And especially if they're restricted to just capital funding, is that something that the government will be considering going forward?
We do take that into account, and you know, we very much recognise that concern, and there are other parts of government where some changes have been made to give more assurance to certain sectors. I think, you know, for instance, the third sector and some various funds. In terms of this fund, because it's capital intensive, we are very much at the behest of Jeremy Hunt, the UK Chancellor, standing up and announcing what the UK Government budget is. So we are not in the same position as the UK Government in terms of being able to give those multi-year guarantees. But what we have been doing, we have been funding multi-year projects. So the funding in the draft budget, as well as the previous funding, are going towards, in many cases, multi-year projects. So, but I take the point, which is clearly looking ahead. For several years ahead, there may be projects that require several years of commitment, and we clearly are not in a position to give that just now because of the financial constraints.
I think some of the evidence we took was around that they weren't getting, the time the allocation of funding was given was around about November, if I'm correct, and they had to spend that money by March. And because of that, we actually heard some evidence around some of the projects just didn't bother to apply because practicality, and you said to them that they wouldn't be able to adhere to the rules, the regulations. So it's just bringing that to your attention, Minister, and potentially what the Scottish Government can do to look at that, because of course some of these projects could be very viable.
Yes, and I'll take that point away and certainly reflect upon it, and I'm sure it's no doubt something the committee will be raising as well. There's not necessarily easy answers to those questions, but I just want to assure you we are conscious of that. We've had similar feedback from the groups.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. You mentioned earlier on participatory budgeting in terms of the Just Transition Fund and that it's been a success. and you said you were, the government wanted to build on that success. How do you see that success going forward, and will it lead to a widening of engagement?
Thanks. Well, from the word go, we were persuaded that participatory budgeting was a very important element of delivering the Just Transition Fund in North East Scotland and Moray, for engaging with communities, for that bottom-up approach to allow communities and groups to come together and decide what the Just Transition means for them, and then come up with projects that could help deliver that in their own communities. So a lot of really good, exciting, innovative, creative thinking going on within communities over the Just Transition. So in terms of raising awareness and engagement, I think it's been very helpful. I obviously indicated before that 10,000 people voted first time for the projects, that was 19,000, so awareness is raising and engagement's raising as well, and that's some evidence of it. So we're committed to delivering at least £1 million a year over the course of this Parliament for participatory budgeting, so it will continue. And, you know, obviously I'm MSP for Moray, so I meet the groups in my own area in particular, and it's really inspirational to see how they're addressing this and the debates that are taking place and discussions and what the Just Transition means for various communities within my area, and likewise that's happening in Aberdeenshire and Aberdeen City. And the third sector organisations are helping run this for us. Well, they actually run it on our behalf. They're funded to do that. So the third sector is playing a very important role here as well.
Okay, thank you for that.
Thank you. Do you reckon, we did get some evidence, it's from Moray TUC, that there is a trade-off with participatory budgeting. So while it does do, you know, achieve what you've described, maybe public engagement and enthusiasm around certain projects, they suggest that it doesn't always give an objective criteria of need and merit. And I think they highlight that in round one of the fund, around 50% of funds went to organisations in the most affluent ward and forests. So while participatory budgeting is positive and does deliver some of the benefits you've described, how do you make sure that organisations that or areas that maybe have less capacity or have less experience in this kind of field of participating, or have less, a smaller population, so there's just less votes to go in if people tend to do it in a geographic area, which often they do, how do we, you know, make sure that the negatives don't outweigh the positives when it comes to participatory budgeting, or does there need to be a mix of ways in which the budgeting is the resources are distributed?
Yeah. Well, if anyone's got the answer on how to avoid trade-offs, I'm all ears. I think that's something we all struggle with and always have done. Clearly, at some point, you have to take a decision and just open funds and work with people to make the best of what's available. There is, you know, there's no way of avoiding trade-offs. Even the circumstance you give in, you know, the most affluent ward and forest, for instance, receiving funds, the projects will benefit the whole community. So looking at it just through one lens is not always helpful. Obviously, I'd have to check out exactly what they said, but, you know, you get my gist. So a lot of the projects are about tackling some of the inequalities that I mentioned at the beginning of the meeting today, in terms of the Just Transition is about good green jobs. It's also about tackling some of the social ills and inequalities we have in our society. So if you live in energy-rich Moray, but you can't afford to pay your fuel bills, you know, as part of the Just Transition, we have to address some of those issues. So some of these small local projects can help make a difference to some local people, and therefore they're important. And we have to spread that ethos throughout the whole of the country for the national transition across Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Just a couple of things. So just for clarity, in terms of the fund, did you say that in this year is when you would be doing an analysis of the fund? Did I pick that up correct?
Well, what I'm saying is yes, this year we're determined to take stock this year, uh-huh, of many elements of it. You've covered a few of them here. Obviously, I think once you report to us or issue your report from your inquiry, there'll be helpful information or ideas within that to help us. There are some issues you've raised today which I certainly want to take away and, uh-huh, sort out this year. Okay. Some of the communication issues and how we report and so on.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing was around, there are delays to several strategies and plans that are relevant to this. Just Transition, for the draft energy strategy is delayed, the Just Transition plan is delayed, regional Just Transition plans, climate change update. I mean, I know they don't all come under your portfolio, but can you give us an indication of when we can expect these plans to be published, which obviously have an impact on the 10-year plan for Moray and Aberdeen?
I'm happy to write back to the committee with some of the timelines, but in a broad context, we've said that by the summer we'll publish the final version and the final document in terms of the energy strategy and just transition plan. And also, we in 2024 will be beginning work to kind of put in place the framework for how we're going to take forward regional just transition plans for Scotland. That'll obviously take some time, but we're beginning the work this year on how to take that forwards and the framework for doing that. And in terms of the sectoral plans, the three that are underway just now, the consultation's taking place. And I'm trying to, I'll ask Katrina just to give us a latest estimate of when they'll be available.
Yeah, I hope that the three draft just transition plans will be published before the summer as well. We don't have a timetable for the final ones, so the drafts will be obviously ones that we'll then want to consult on.
And also the committee have an interest in the Grangemouth one, given we did the inquiry in that area and the recent announcements from Ineos. Do we have a timescale for the finalisation of that plan that you're aware of?
Yeah, it's probably best I write back to you with the latest timeline for all of these different plans.
Okay, thank you. That brings us to the end of the evidence session this morning. Thank you to the Minister and Katrina Lang for joining us. And we now move into private session.